as we talk about the stars of the NHRA, let me introduce who's here today. To my left, we have Erica Ender. She's a two-time pro stock champion. One of the things that I love about Erica Enders is how many people, when you get the question, who would play you in a movie? Well, someone has played Erica in a movie. It was Beverly Mitchell. She was her story was part of Right on Track, a Disney movie as a kid. Beverly Mitchell. We have the 2017 Top Fuel World Champion, Brittany Force, on stage with us as well. Leah Pritchett, the 2018 Factory Stock World Champion. And the winningest female in all motorsports at 42 wins and a three-time pro stock motorcycle champion, Angelle Sampey. Angelle, I'll kick it off with you. Why drag racing?
I thought I was going to go last.
That's why I did it.
I don't know. I started riding dirt bikes when I was only 6 years old. I actually made a joke about it on a radio show that I did the other day. My mom was 3 months pregnant for me when she fell off of the back of a dirt bike, and we think something happened to me in the womb. Because I am literally addicted to motorcycles. I've tried to get away from it. My parents tried to get me away from it. They put me in pageants at one stage of my life to introduce me to more girly things, and I'm so thankful that they did, because it helped me a lot with stage presence and being able to speak to people, you know, like I am today. But the motorcycle passion never left me, and I just knew from a little girl that I was going to race motorcycles. I wasn't really good on the dirt track. I would be the first one to the turn and then get past. So my mom always said, well, maybe she'll be a drag racer. And here I am.
You talk in your bio how becoming a mother has changed your kind of approach to competition and what you're out here competing for. How do your children inspire you?
I was a late mom. I didn't have my little girl till I was 40 years old. So I got a lot of things knocked out of my life that I wanted to do before becoming a mom, because I knew that things were going to change for me as far as how, you know, how daring I'd be after she was born. And I actually retired from drag racing in 2009 and had my little girl in 2011 and swore that I'd never, ever go back to the racetrack again because it was just too dangerous. At least that's what I was thinking at the time. And then my little girl started watching the things I was doing and paying attention to, you know, hard work and determination, and I tried to tell her what I did as a racer and how I did it, but it wasn't the same as showing her. You know, I didn't want her to just read magazines or look at videos, so I got a call one day asking me to return to drag racing. I was scared to death because, you know, I didn't want to put my life in any kind of danger, but I realized how controlled our environment is and how awesome our safety safari is, and if I'm going to ride motorcycles on the racetrack is definitely the place to do it. And what better way to show my little girl that she can do anything she wants to do? So I decided to return, and the struggles at first were terrible. I wasn't that good when I first came back, and so she really got to learn the whole thing. She saw me struggle, but she saw me work really hard, and she saw that I wasn't going to quit. And I did get my first win as a mom in 2016, and you can hear my voice starting to shake because I'll never lose the feeling of that day when I held that trophy up and I said, Ava, mommy did it. And that trophy sits in her room. That trophy sits in her room under a sign that says, dreams only work if you do. So I definitely live every day to show her what's possible if you just work hard.
That's awesome. Wow. Leah, we heard in the video, you said that drag racing, you don't choose drag racing chooses you. How did it happen for you?
Well, that is definitely a motto that I live and breathe, I think, since I have been 8 years old. I grew up in just a regular, normal family where my dad clearly wanted boys, and he didn't have them. He had two girls, so, like, he was stuck with that. But short stories, he was a land speed racer, not a drag racer, didn't hold an NHRA license. He was a street racer. But he wanted to race with his girls, and NHRA has a junior series where now you can start when you're 5 years old. And at that time, in the early 1990s, I started when I was eight, or late 1990s. And so that's where that actually originates from, because no eight-year-old out there is like, that, you know, that's drag racing, that's what I want to do. You do have to be presented that opportunity. You know, if you're born into a soccer family, it's probably what you're going to play, and you're going to play club or volleyball, whatever it may be. And Eric and I share a similar upbringing in that motorsports family, so to speak. But for me, I did not want to race at all. until like a month before my birthday because my older sister was racing and she was not doing very well and it wasn't very fun and we were losing all the time. And I was like, I do not want any part of that. But just like your older sibling wears that shirt or has their hair like that, you want to do what they do. So I was like, oh, of course I want to race. So started racing. My sister and I started building off of each other, doing better, winning races, then traveling. And then all of a sudden I went to a national event, just like the one that's here. It was actually the world finals just like this when I was about 12. And I fell in love with the sport, every single portion of it. And it wasn't my dad bringing me to the race. It wasn't any of that. It was me and my group of people, my 12-year-old, you know, teeter-totter friends, in the grandstands, like, having our eardrums blasted out, seeing Pedal Fest, seeing Eddie Hill go 300 miles an hour, going in the pits, waiting for her dad's autograph for 2 hours, buying an $18 hot dog, the whole bit. And I'm like, oh my gosh, how do you become a professional race car driver? Like, and from there, we're all just, we love this so much, and we all, it's so unique is that this group of us all became professionals in our own right, whether we're drivers or mechanics, or some of them are professional engine builders for junior racers and are helping the next developmental program rise and come above. So it was, you know, drag racing doesn't choose you, you choose drag racing. I chose drag racing because it's what spoke to me and it's what I've dedicated my life to. And you know, I feel like I've had multiple lives in this and I feel like I'm starting a new chapter. That was getting to be a professional race car driver. I'm here now, and now it's not surviving as a professional race car driver, it's thriving, and what do those next steps mean? And I look to my other female counterparts as encouragement, watching what they do, how they do it, and also, I think we're all responsible for the next step of our sport. And so I feel like we have a really good company here in order to achieve that together, even, you know, when we're not racing each other.
When you talk about thriving, I do want to give it up to Leah Pritchett. We found out earlier this year during a social media conference that she is actually one of the top 20 female recognized brands in the world. So great on that, Leah.
Appreciate that. Thank you. And I'll give it up to my my brand manager, Katie, who's also my my girlfriend from kindergarten. We have a 12-year hiatus, but she is a huge part of why we're the number one social media leader in the sport of drag racing, too. So thank you, Katie. Girl power, that's what's up.
You may have heard the voice on the video say that Steve must be shaken in his boots. We are coming off of a great weekend. We had an epic race in Vegas. When this weekend wraps, the two next to me could walk away champions. That's how tight the points race is in their two classes. Brittany Force won in 2017 against Steve Torrance. We're almost entering back in with the same storyline. You can't even write it. Brittany Force, daughter of John Force, you grew up around this sport. Walk us through how you knew the drag racing bug had bit you.
I always loved the sport of drag racing. I grew up out at these racetracks with my sisters when we were little babies with pacifiers in our mouth. It was home for us. And these crew guys, these crew chiefs, people I compete against now were always family to me. So I always knew I'd be involved in the sport of drag racing. It wasn't until, I want to say, 16, 17 years old, I jumped into a super comp dragster. Like Leah said, you want to be everything your older sister does, you want to do. She got in a super comp car. She got into an A-fuel dragster. Courtney and I followed right in her footsteps. And it really wasn't until 2010, I made my first full pass. I had the opportunity to drive a top fuel car. That was never my intention, never my plan. At the time, I was driving A-fuel. I loved A-fuel. And I was only racing about 16 events in a season. I was still going to school, but I loved my A-fuel dragster. And kind of that was my plan, was to pursue that. To me, top fuel, I thought was absolutely nuts. I thought, there's no way you're ever gonna get me in one of those things. I've sat at the 1,000-foot marker when those things blow past you, and I thought, those drivers are absolutely nuts. They're crazy. You won't ever get me in one of those. And then the opportunity came along, and I said, sure, I'll jump in one, and we'll make some passes, and we'll go from there. And then when it all came down to it, I thought, holy shit, what did I get myself into? I signed up for it, and now let's climb in. And really, it's the nerves, it's the fear of the unknown. It was a new car for me. I wasn't familiar with it. If something goes wrong, are you going to react in the right way? And it's just the unfamiliar. But once I got in that thing, I worked my way down the racetrack, months of testing, and it was in Las Vegas. I made my first full pass down the racetrack in a top fuel car, and I knew I was hooked. I knew that's the direction I was going, and I fell in love, not from, you know, being a kid in the stands, but driving, piloting that car.
Well, this year, Brittany Force set the laps time record, which is one of the barrier or one of the benchmarks that our sport is ranked on. We just come off of Vegas, where she is the fastest in top fuel ever. Just a guess, what do you think that was? Might have seen it in the video. Just a guess, throw it out there. How fast do you think she went? 338.
338 miles per hour.
Miles an hour. They are crossing 3 football fields in 3.6 seconds. It's absolutely mind-blowing, and that's why we keep saying you have to see it in person to believe it. Erica Enders, star of a Disney movie, which is just amazing. I grew up watching it. It's nice to know you, Erica. You enter into the weekend. You're looking for your third championship in pro stock. It's been a couple of rocky years. You've addressed the valley, but let us know on how drag racing really came into your life.
So my sister Courtney and I grew up watching my dad race, just sportsman hobby racing on the weekends, and that's just what our family did. We both played sports all through high school and college, but growing up younger watching him, I thought I was his crew chief, so I'd walk around with the little red shop rag, and he'd let me write his dial in with shoe polish on his window, and I just thought that was the coolest thing ever. So that's what I wanted to do. I decided at like a really young age, I wanted to be like my dad. So fortunately, Leah talked about it. NHRA came out with the Junior Drag Racing League, where at the time kids from 8 to 17 could drive. And I remember reading the article in our National Dragster, which is our series publication. And I said, Dad, look, they're going to let kids drive. Do you think I can do it? And he looked at me and he's like, well, you're a good kid. You make good grades. I don't see why not. And he built me a car. I started driving when I was 8 years old. And ever since then, he jokes all the time. He said, I got out of the car after the first pass and said, I want to go faster, Daddy, faster. So ever since then, that's been our goal, and it's been a part of our family's lives forever. So 28 years now I've been driving, and just whatever the next benchmark is what I look to accomplish, and it's been a blast, man. It's like you talked about the valleys, but the valleys are what make the good times so much sweeter.
All right, well, I'm going to open up the panel, so it's not directed to anyone, so jump in. First question, do you feel that it's more challenging being a female in this sport?
Yes. No doubt. And I can't speak for everybody, and we all have different examples and scenarios that we've been through, but I would say the challenges are there before you even know it. The challenges are happening behind the scenes, at least how I've experienced them. It hasn't been for a couple years after. My motto is, nobody can help you unless you, I don't want to say ask for help. It's not a handout, but it's a hand up. So if you share your dreams and your passion and your goals with other people, and you know you're not capable of doing it yourself, that's an opportunity for people to help. It's also a window and an opportunity for people to criticize and laugh. Yeah. And go, like, 5 years later, like, Leah, I remember when you said you were going to run top fuel, and we just laughed. But they're like, oh, well, good job. Well, thank you for keeping that in for 5 years. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you could have told me that then, and then I could have got it done sooner, because then I would have proved you wrong sooner. But there's those challenges. You know, I experienced recent challenges. This last SEMA, I had the best SEMA. For those of you that don't know, the Special Equipment Market Association, in Las Vegas, the largest automotive aftermarket convention in the entire world. So we go there to spend time with our fans, our sponsors, network, in 5-6 full days of everything. And on the very last day, I had a person that very much, you know, I thought could be a great potential sponsor, and met with his team and his people and the money and coming to Pomona, and come to find out he just had alternative motives at the end of the day, and I'm sure we've all experienced that. But to get that far and to be at this level of professionalism, and for me to bring in my team of people and then find out still at the same time, like, you wouldn't do that to Home Slice over here that you're also going to meet at the race. And there's just so many other situations that you have to guard yourself with. And when you guard yourself, then you end up being a tougher person. And a tougher person isn't the person with a smile on your face all the time. So then you end up being labeled that B word. So the challenges that come, we prepare for, but that definitely changes us. And so I would say the answer is yes.
Angelle?
I wanted to add to it. I started a lot earlier than these three beautiful young ladies. I'm probably old enough to be their mom. But when
you don't
I
look it.
when I started, I was not accepted. It was really ugly, the things that were said to me and done to me to try to get me to quit because they just simply did not want to race against me. But that actually is not the toughest challenge that I've experienced as a female in racing. And the biggest one came for me when Ava was born, and it's because now I have to leave my family. I also have a foster daughter at home. She's 5 years old. And I have to leave my family at home and do this, and I struggle on a daily basis if I'm making the right decision. You know, should I be home with my daughters and my husband, or should I be doing this to show them what they can do? And ultimately, I've decided that doing this is the right decision because my daughter actually loves traveling with me, Ava, the 8-year-old. And I think the separation that we have, when I am at the races is really good for us because when I'm home, we're together all the time. But it's a big struggle that I think the men that we race with don't feel, and I don't mean to take anything away from our father or our husband, but it's just a different feeling. You know, me being in a hotel room alone, knowing that my kids are at home without me, I struggle with that. And I don't think the guys really feel that way, you know, because mom's at home with the kids, and that's a really hard thing for me to do. It's hard for me to go to sleep at night wondering if I'm making the right decision, but hopefully I am.
Brittany?
I haven't really experienced, those same kind of issues, obviously. To me, the sport of NHRA drag racing, I've always felt very welcomed into the sport, especially by, males in the sport, people I compete against. I remember driving A-fuel dragsters, and I remember Tony Schumacher, Morgan Lucas, Brandon Bernstein, throughout my years of driving, coming over to me and telling me, come jump in my top fuel car. We need to get you in a top fuel car. So I've actually had, a different experience. I've always felt welcomed. I think it has a lot to do, obviously, who my dad is and growing up in the sport. I've known these people for years, but that's kind of been my view on it.
For people that may not know, John Force is a legend in the NHRA. He is the winningest driver in history. Grandstands are named after him. And I'm sure there's a lot of pressure that comes with that, being his daughter. Erica, you compete in a class that is dominated by men. The barriers that you've broken in pro stock, how have you experienced the challenges with the other species?
That's a perfect way to put it. When I got hired to drive professionally, I was 19 years old, so I made the decision if I was going to finish college or do both at the same time, which I did. And when I first came out, it was terrible. And I hate to talk about the negative aspect of it, but I was tough on the exterior. I get told to smile a lot, but I'm always thinking. So I had I'm more shy than most, especially my sister. So I had this struggle with them looking at me differently and saying there is a reason why women don't drive these cars. In the type of car that I drive, you have to leave with a clutch. It's a 5-speed transmission, so you have to manually shift the car going down the track. You're in high gear by half track, which is 4 seconds into the run. They're already completed their runs at that time, but it's a lot going on in the cockpit. You have to be physically strong. And so there was all this doubt that was automatically just planted in my brain, and that's not the house I grew up in. We were told we could do anything we've set our minds to, surround yourself with the right people and go for it. But it was brutal. I would go to my hotel room and call my dad and just cry on the phone. The way I would sum it up if I had to is that I had to dig my way back to ground zero before I could ever show somebody what I was capable of. So that aspect of it really sucked. But it made me stronger, and Leah touched on it, and it's something that I've struggled with these past 2 years because personally I've had a tough time with it, but it makes you tough, it makes you hard, it makes you callous, and you don't want to become bitter because what a blessing it is to do what we do, to do what you love and what you're good at for a living with people that you love, just to be criticized and ridiculed and kicked. So it was definitely interesting. And our class, Pro Stock, is the good old boys class. That's what they've always called it, the factory hot rod class. So it was a struggle, but now we're looked at differently. And the B word is brought up a lot also because I'm the only one out there, but I just want to beat them. That's it. All of them.
And she does. She's known as an assassin on the tree. They fear her more than you fear them. Do you feel like it's getting better?
Oh, much better. I mean, we have so many girls in the pro stock motorcycle class now, and they're welcome with open arms. You know, like Erica went through a lot of what I went through because she was the first in pro stock cars. And I'm a little bit, I don't want to say jealous because I don't like that word, but I'm a little envious of how they're accepted, and I wasn't. I was kicked like you were, and it was hard, and I wanted to quit on a daily basis, but I kept going in spite of them. I actually, when I won my first championship, stood up on the stage, and I thanked my competitors for being so nasty and rude to me. and I said it. I said, it's because of you that I am who I am today. Wow. And it was pretty silent. I didn't get too many claps. But I'm really glad that we all have been a part of making it better for the girls that come along today. I feel proud now. I'm not quite as envious anymore. I feel like I'm the one that helped to open that door.
One thing with the NHRA, every ticket is a pit pass. So anyone that comes to our events can go straight up to the ropes, meet these ladies, meet other competitors. You guys live in this role model position. Is it a challenge?
I think it's an honor. I remember being that little girl on the other side of the ropes, waiting for Angelle's autograph, waiting for her dad's autograph, waiting for Shelley Anderson, Shirley Muldowney, these strong, independent, successful women that were doing what I wanted to do. So I remember that look that I had in my eye, and I recognize it. You don't see it a whole bunch, but every once in a while you recognize that look, and it doesn't even necessarily have to be from a little girl. It could be a boy also, but it's an honor to be in that position, and I do my best every day to represent what I believe in well, and I like it. It's surreal. It's a cool position to be in.
It's definitely one of the best parts about my job is, you know, going out to the ropes and having kids come up, boys or girls, and they're in their fire suit. They're, you know, running junior dragsters that weekend, and, you know, they'll tell me, they'll ask for advice or tell me they want to be a top field driver when they grow up, and those moments, like what you were just saying, it keeps you grounded because there's days where you're out early and you're upset, you're mad, you screwed up, and you just want to, you know, get to the next race and put it all behind you. You don't even want to take the time. And it's like in those moments where you have a little kid tell you something, that's what pulls you back down to earth and, you know, makes you realize really what is important. And it's one of the best parts of my job. If I could inspire, you know, kids out there, that's pretty cool to be able to do that.
I would most definitely echo them. I don't think it's a challenge, but I think there's definitely an adaptability factor to it. So, right, we have these fans and we have these kids, and what they see is definitely the limelight, right? So in sports, they see the guy and the touchdown and holding Heisman and, I mean, all the glory portions of it, and they don't see the hard work. And so you have to understand that that's all that they see. So where I come from is, like, the absolute, like, grit, passion of racing in Tucson when, like, there is no track prep and it's just sand and there's no fans. It's just pure beating the brakes off the guy in the other lane on a Wednesday night. So, and I loved the racing portion of it. And I did not know, if you asked me today, if you knew that professional drag racing, that this would be it. To be totally honest, I may not be as certain in what I'm doing today because I wasn't in the beginning able to adapt to what those new opportunities were to be, or even, I don't want to say the pressure of being a role model, but I literally was so stupid, I didn't give that enough thought. I I would love to race. Let's go racing. Let's have cool partners. Let's go to the NHRA national event. And then having that opportunity. So now it is such a blessing. And that's why I echo that. And it brings me, it hits so much more home for me than it ever did because I don't want to say it was a surprise in a way, but I never truly thought that I would ever get here. And then once you're there, it's like, oh, okay. Well, now we're really going to do this. But it's amazing. And we have all seen how people's lives have been changed. Families have been changed. Kids that have modeled their entire education, their schooling, their education, their life towards becoming a professional mechanic, racer, engineer, technician, whatever it may be, based off of an experience that we gave them. And that right there is completely priceless. And so I know that each one of you have a part in what you do on a daily basis, and you don't get to see exactly how that affects their life, but I guarantee you it does. And so it's amazing when we actually get to see the next year when we visit Denver or Seattle or Pomona, and they're like, look, I graduated with this, or look at this Wally that you inspired me to win. It's like, that's flooring for sure.
All right, proudest moments of your career so far.
I think I've discussed that one already. When I won my first Wally as a mom, I would give the 3 championships and the 41 wins before it away for that one win. It just meant so much more to me, and it has a lot to do with what we just talked about. I actually have to admit that I didn't really understand the importance of being a role model to the little kids out there until my kids arrived. I kind of just looked past that a lot like what Leah's saying. I just saw the part of I just want to be a drag racer. I just want to kick everybody's butt. I don't care about the fans. I don't care about this. I don't care about that. I just want to race. That's all I kept thinking. And then I one day, you know, saw the light that that part is so much more important than anything else, because if it weren't for the fans or the little people looking up to us, we wouldn't have our jobs. And then when Ava arrived, I really understood the importance of being a role model. And so definitely I understand it, and I do a better job at it now. I'm sorry that I didn't do a better job at it earlier, but my proudest moment is hoisting that Wally and saying, Ava, mommy did it.
You're the only one that can say that.
You know, I think they can all agree with me. We're the women, you know, the girls that do this, the women that do that, and that we just want to be racers. But it changes when you become a mom, and I really hope the same for all 3 of you. I have the best of both worlds now, and you can't even imagine how important what you do now is going to be when you get to share that with a child.
So maybe, I mean, we have all the role model relationships and roles to play, but, like, you can be our role model, because there's not that many of them for us in this space, so thank you
exactly.
for that.
Exactly, and that makes me feel so good that you say that.
Good.
I appreciate
it.
Thank you.
I would say my proudest moment in drag racing, it won't always be my last win, but I'm going to say my last win, and my last win was Brainerd, Minnesota of this year. We had gone 26 races over a season without winning, and it's not necessarily because of that. It's a multifold tier reasons, but one, I had been in a major slump, and we won that race based on pure performance from the car, myself. I don't want to say we were unbeatable, but everything was on its game, and I was able to prove to myself. So when you dig your absolute deepest and you don't think you can dig any deeper and it cuts, and you find, like, bone, that's what that race was for me, so I knew I could do that. But at the same time, it doesn't take away from world championships, from 22 years of racing, from the other teams that I've helped build. It's the most proudest because it's the team that I've built for 3 years that have had my back and I had theirs, and we were able to come up with the absolute success that we've been looking for and we could feed off of, and that's, I'm living right now in the moment. So my proudest moment is the one that I'm living with and on and growing from, and not living in the past.
I have a couple that I'd like to share. Obviously, 2017, when we won the championship, absolute proudest moment, accomplishing that with my team. First female to do that in 35 years in top fuel, and the first top fuel car to do that in John Force Racing. So that was huge on its own. And just being in the hype of it all and ending up on top. But also, in the footage earlier, I wrecked in Pomona, and coming back from that was probably one of the toughest, biggest battles ever. Climbing back in that car in Phoenix, it was 2 weeks later, that was definitely one of the toughest things, but ended up being one of the proudest moments. It was not easy putting that out of my head. I was still black and blue when I got to Phoenix, and I'm my dad's kid. I knew I never say no. You jump in and you toughen up and climb back in that car and make that first pass. And I knew it was going to be a tough one, but that was probably my biggest battle and one of my proudest moments.
I would say 2014, our first world championship, which is the first one for a female in our class of pro stock racing for 50 years. So that day, coming into the race, we won Vegas, which was the week prior. We took the points lead, but we were only ahead by 19 points, and each round is worth 20. So Jason Lyon, the guy that was in the number 2 position, was right on my heels. We qualified on opposite sides of the ladder, and we both made it to the finals, where that round was winner take all. If we would have lost that day, we would have lost the world championship by 1 point, and we won by 19. So that moment, that year everything. Like, I raced for this guy, Victor Cagnazzi, that gave me my start for a number of years, and it was the hardest thing in my life to leave that team to come to where I'm at Elite Motorsports, and to be able to accomplish what we did that year, our first year together, and since then has just been awesome, but it was definitely my proudest moment that day.
Brittany, you talked about the on-track incident. You guys have all seen or been a part of very dangerous situations. Is the danger somewhere in your mind when you're competing?
I think you respect it. I don't think you are. I don't dwell on it. I don't get in the car and buckle in and say, well, dang, I hope I don't crash. Like, it's not it's not in the back of my mind, but you respect what can happen at the speeds that we compete at. But it is the absolute most controlled environment that you can be in with our safety safari that Angelle and Leah touched on. They are all there. There's life flight there. There's a doctor on staff. I mean, it's as safe as we can possibly make it. I had a really horrible fire in my twin turbo Pro Mod car in Norwalk and proposed like 8 different rule changes to NHRA, all of which were accepted. So I think our job in the car as a driver is to make it safer, and all of those rules are in place because somebody was hurt or something bad happened before. So you just kind of have to learn from those experiences, but I respect it, not scared of it.
It is in the back of your mind. You don't focus on it, you don't replay it or think about it, but it is always in the back of your mind, and I think it keeps you aware, it keeps you on your toes, and I think I think it just keeps you aware of what's out there, what can go wrong, and that you got to react like that in any situation.
I'm very aware of it. I'm exposed. I don't have a roll cage or a seatbelt or a Hans device or anything. I have one layer of leather on top of my skin and a helmet, and I'm very aware of things like crosswinds and track conditions, and I consider that every time I pop the clutch, that I want to stay shiny side up every single run down the track. So if there's anything that I feel going wrong, if the wind gets me too bad and it starts to go towards the wall or the center line, I have to shut off. And that's something that I didn't always do in the past. You know, I've scuffed the wall, I've run over cones, and I've run over a cone this year. Didn't mean to do it, but there's just a point where you have to say, I want to race next weekend, so I'm going to roll off the throttle. And as racers, we all know how hard that is to do, especially during eliminations. But as I've gotten older, I've gotten wiser with knowing how to protect myself. And unfortunately, that happens. That's another thing I can help you with. You get older and you want to slow down a little bit, but I just want to race again next weekend.
I compete in 2 different categories, Top Fuel with a 330, almost 38 mile an hour, 335, and then a door car that's only 175 miles an hour. It's a 3-speed leap with a 2-step, 2 totally separate animals, and I race them on the same day and swap back and forth. And I have to remind myself what driving one is like versus the other one, but not just from a procedure standpoint, but from the safety aspect. So I think it goes hand in hand between optimal performance and safety. So if you are going to perform your best for ultimately winning that race, you're going to do what's quickest to the finish line first. And if anything jeopardizes that in the way, you have a decision to make, right? Are you going to pedal that car? Are you going to short shift it? What's the competition doing? So to Brittany's point of being on your A game and reacting as quick as possible, but also knowing that whatever decision you make, that your team is behind you and they back you. So if you decide to abort a run and you thought it didn't feel right and something was wrong and was broken that may puncture a tire and take out a wing and put you into the wall, that was your decision and they have to back you for it. Or if you take it and something happens, that was also your decision. But knowing when you come back that no matter what, they have your back, you get to eliminate and check that off the box. Because for us, we race, we're the last ones to touch the bike, to touch the car, to stage it and take it to the finish line, and we get the glory. But they're the ones that brought us there. So their validation, and hopefully I speak for all of us, their validation means everything, right? Our partners, our fans, but those that brought us to there mean everything. So whatever decision we make for us as safety, we know that we're not gonna come back. And given there have been team owners out there, why didn't you stay in it? I would have stayed in it. We would have won that race. Well, you know what? You weren't in the car. And I was, and we're here to talk about it another day. So from a safety aspect, it's race smart and race competitively, but the comfort of your team of people and whoever your team of people, you know, if you make a mistake, if you're gonna come back and someone's gonna whiplash you for it, you're gonna be timid and shy, but we need to stay on that level, stay on that edge. Like if I red light in qualifying, my crew chief is like, I know you were trying and let's go get it again, don't back off. There's just a certain level of comfortability when it comes to safety outside of the apparatuses. It has very much everything to do with the people that you surround yourself with.
Well said.
Wow. Yeah. We're very hopeful that you guys are gonna join us this weekend in Pomona. If you've never been to a drag race, what should these people know?
It's loud. Bring your phones.
So you know when you go to a concert and everybody's like got their phones out, taping it the whole time, right? And they're not watching the concert. I don't know if you upload it, probably this group probably doesn't do that. But you upload it, nobody's watching your concert video, right? It's not the same. Coming to an NHRA drag race blows out of the water any concert you're ever gonna go to, because concerts, you can kind of, you can hear it, you can see it, you can smell whatever else is going on. Here, every single one of your senses are completely, not only touched, but obliterated. Mm-hmm. So, right, you think you're not an emotional person, you're gonna cry. You're around the nitro cars, and even hers, because when she gets up and she wins, she's gonna make you cry too. And she's gonna cry with you when she wins. So it's got like tears of victory everywhere. But I'll let other people explain. But it's a sensory overload from, I mean, we're at 12,000 horsepower per lane in the nitro category. There's nothing louder in the world. There's nothing more accelerating. And I mean, you stick a mellow yellow can on the grandstands and a car goes by, it shakes, knocks itself right over. If there's anybody that never needs to think that they're dead, they just need to go to a drag race.
Exactly.
We will remind them that they are alive.
If there's any question if Leah Pritchett loves this sport, I think that answer bakes it. Brittany, what would you tell someone?
There's nothing like it. You can't compare it to anything in this world. It's the most extreme sport out there. And I've been coming to the drag race since I was a baby. And when I stand on that starting line, when my dad launches, I'm still standing there shaking. Just, you feel it in your chest, the ground shakes, your ears are ringing, your eyes are watering, you can't breathe. There's absolutely nothing like it. And there's nothing like it. There's absolutely nothing like it in the world. And like I said, I've been out here my whole life and I'm still blown away when I see those cars go down the track.
It's pretty awesome. I don't think TV does it justice, although they do a great job. All of your senses, like these ladies talked about, are just blown out of the park. So it's in your backyard this weekend. I hope that you ladies come join us.
I'd like to add one thing, just to brag on us, on our whole, everybody we race with a little bit. We're so unlike other sports, whether it be NASCAR, football, hockey. Like you said earlier, when you get that ticket to walk in the gate, it's also your pit pass. You can stand 5 feet from my motorcycle while they're warming it up. You can stand right by her car and cry, like she said, when that nitromethane gets you. But the drivers are all there and all willing to meet you and say hi and sign autographs and take pictures and kiss babies and even sign some of them. So, we're very open and willing and wanting to meet the fans. And I especially love to educate people on pro stock motorcycles because we don't have the ground pounding thunder that they have. And sometimes the fans will walk out of the stands when we come up to the starting line, and it's very disappointing. So if I can get just one fan a weekend and teach them about how awesome pro stock motorcycles are and have them stay in the stands and watch us, then I feel like I've won that weekend. So if you guys do make it out there, please come to the pro stock bike pits and check us out.
Well, you guys have survived the panel discussion. We have one last thing for you. We're calling this 0 to 60, so it's going to be quick answers. I'm so glad you guys are all lobbed because we don't have to pass mics, so just shout it out, okay? 0 to 60. Pre-race ritual.
I always get on the left side of the motorcycle.
Fist pumping all of my guys and like actually knocking one out.
It's a song in the tow car, fist pumps, and the same drink that's in my car all day long.
I put my gear on in the same order.
I've watched her. She does this whole routine with stretching her feet.
I do. And if you come talk to me while I'm stretching, I have to start over because I'm superstitious. So
put your earbuds in. Yeah. Not today.
Okay, I need a name. We want a real answer for this. Person you love to beat.
Eddie Krawick. Can't stand him either. And he happens to be my teammate.
What day of the week is this?
Yeah.
Name.
Steve Torrance.
Right there with you, Steve Torrance.
Greg Anderson.
If not drag racing, what?
Here. I would want to work here, so when I'm not racing anymore, I would love an application. I seriously started college in television productions. Lauren has my dream job. I want to be behind the camera, not in front of it. I love editing stuff, so Angelle Sampey at Angelle Sampey Racing at gmail.com. Please send me an application.
I always wanted to be a professional volleyball player.
I went to school to be a teacher, so that'd be my plan, but I can't see. Looking back on that when I was a kid, I don't know.
Do your homework faster.
I don't know how I got there. But I'd somehow be involved in drag racing no matter what.
A lawyer.
Really?
I don't know why.
Good one.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. What word describes you?
Determined.
Same.
Relentless.
I had that in my mind for you.
Thank you.
I see it too.
I'll get it tattooed later.
Driven.
Yeah, I would say determined and goal setter.
Morning or night?
Night.
Night.
Night. Well, the morning goes into the night. The night goes into the morning. There we go.
Dogs or cats?
Oh,
dogs.
Wow.
Cats.
I used to be a dog person, but we have a cat now. She's the best cat ever. Her name's Harley, because I race a Harley Davidson.
What category do you enjoy watching that's not your own?
Pro mod.
Funny car.
That's mean. Because I don't
Pro
say,
stock bike.
No, I like all of them because they all race, and that's the truth. I love her, but of course Top Fuel because Antron Brown's one of my favorite people in the whole world.
I go back to the sportsman classes like stock, super stock, comp eliminator.
For social media, Twitter or Instagram?
Instagram.
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 I don't even know Twitter, so Instagram.
All right, and for this last one, I want you to use your hands on a scale. From 1 to 10, how irritated are you when someone, most likely male, asks you to smile?
Use your hands.
Awesome, give a round of applause for the ladies of the NHRA. Real quickly before we wrap, there are a lot of women in the room that I know a lot of us would be lost with. If you are part of drag racing and you're here today, please stand up. We want to give you a round of applause. And then my counterpart on the NHRA on Fox, Jamie Howe, came out to be a part of this event. You inspire me daily, so thank you for the support.
Thanks, Jamie.
And to the women of Fox Sports, thank you so much for having us. We are so thankful to be here. We hope you come check us out. We would love to have you all out.